because I have such a big family and people are always getting married and having children, there's always been circumcisions throughout my whole life that I've attended. So as far back as I can remember is the first time it entered my consciousness. So every time I had a new cousin that was born, my family would go and attend the bris ceremony. All the men would go on one side of the room, and the women would go on the other side of the room. The mother would bring the child, hand it off to usually the grandfather, who would be holding the child while the moil is circumcising them. And it sort of happens during the morning prayer session. You know, you pray a little bit, there's a little break, and then you do the circumcision, finish the prayers, and then you eat bagels and things like that afterwards to celebrate. I think the first time that I really felt angry that I was circumcised was when I was about 16, and I went to some family wedding, and my parents pointed out the moil who circumcised me, and I felt really, really angry. I understood the effects of circumcision slowly. I think right around when I hit puberty, around 10, 11, 12, I started to realize more things, that the glands, the head of the penis should be covered. I also experienced difficulties masturbating, and my first experience I was bleeding and chafing. And so I didn't consciously understand that it was because of circumcision, but I started to notice all these bad effects. And then once I saw the moil when I was 16, I connected them, and I realized, like, this is what they did. These are the effects. I think that after witnessing so many circumcisions and the metzitzah bepeh, I think that's what I associated with that. And I sort of thought, like, gee, this guy performed metzitzah bepeh on me. Like, that's really, get me really angry. Metzitzah bepeh is a practice that Orthodox Jews do when they circumcise baby boys. After they cut off the foreskin, the moil, the circumciser, sucks the blood from the penis to sort of clean the wound. This practice really shocks people when they first hear about it, but it's a rigorously defended practice amongst Orthodox Jews. So yeah, after my first sexual experience with a girl, a friend of mine, she had been used to dating intact men, and so the experience was very traumatic for both of us, in a sense. And I told my mom after that, I got the courage to say to my mom, like, I didn't want to be circumcised, you circumcised me, and I'm suffering now because of it. You know. And she's basically said, if you want your foreskin back, then just go get it back. You know? And, you know, just kind of joking around, but I think back then it was kind of new to her to question this, you know. Although, I mean, I don't know how she felt when she gave me up to, handed me off to be circumcised, but I think now I've been talking to her more and more, saying, okay, look, I made the German press, you know, so I just told her about it. I didn't send her the article because, well, you know, I was a little apprehensive about her like, fully saying this, because I feel like slowly I can talk to her, you know, and I think now she still says, like, you have to do it, it's something we have to do. But I think she's starting to recognize that I'm harmed by it, you know, and she's accepting that. So I guess when we started, one of the big issues was Wikipedia. Wikipedia had a very, very pro-circumcision stance. And it's because of these pro-circumcision lurkers there And I think around this time there were two websites that popped up, Intactopedia and CircLeaks. And that was kind of interesting to see all this information on there that I didn't know that I wouldn't even think about finding. So I think I learned a lot just from those sites, and just the idea of sort of documenting sort of all the facts that we know and all the studies and putting it in one neat place. That was a really attractive idea. And I think also it's good because if you get into a debate on the comments section of some article, you could just go to Intactopedia and pull something from there and just copy paste it, right? And so that was kind of interesting. But then after a while, I kind of realized that we couldn't tackle the media. You know, there's all that stuff about circumcision and AIDS, and Bill Gates Foundation spends a lot of money on promoting it, and it seemed no way we can penetrate the media. So I thought, well, we have to create our own media. And so that's when I started Intact News. And I guess for the first few months, I would find sort of the latest developments and write an article from an Intactivist perspective. And I think people really responded positively to that. Shortly afterwards, Stephen Sabota from Attorneys for the Rights of the Child asked me to help out with his website and newsletter. So that's what I've been doing, I guess, for almost 2 years, working on that. And that's been a really good experience. And yes, Attorneys for the Rights of the Child has been doing some amazing work in the past, well, since they started, but in the past 2 years, it's been really amazing with the German court decision and now the AAP statement criticizing that and being able to be in that debate. I think I feel really good being a part of that. I was participating in Occupy Wall Street movement, and there were a lot of zines floating around, and I learned a lot about issues from them, so I figured, why not try a zine on circumcision. And so it was about 1 year since I started getting involved with the Intactivist movement, so that zine is a product of 1 year of research. Now there are, you know, a few thousand, maybe a couple thousand copies floating around, and I get people come up to me and they say, oh, I saw someone reading it on the subway the other day, you know. So I think it's good that the information is spreading that way. And like I said, we have to create our own media, and it's just another way to get our message out. First time I put on the bloodstained man suit was in Berlin, and I just showed up at this demonstration on the same day that the German parliament passed the law decriminalizing circumcision and legalizing it, actually. So people approached me and asked me if I wanted to wear it, and I said, maybe. It's very provocative. It's very, it's a very strong visual. I was nervous putting it on in Berlin, but I felt very empowered because there were a lot of people doing it, and there were also having women there also helped a lot, because I mean they weren't circumcised, but still to have that kind of solidarity was really empowering for me. In the past 10 years, I think there's been a number of deaths, infant deaths, from boys who have contracted herpes from the moil, from the circumciser. But it's a rigorously defended practice amongst Orthodox Jews, and I think it's because they're really afraid of any change, and so changing a little bit, they think that the rest of the stuff they practice will be in question, and their identity is going to be in question. So it's a very difficult thing to criticize and to have a dialogue on. But I think the more people know about it, the more the discussion will happen within the Orthodox communities, and the more varied opinions are going to arise.